It's time for Cash Plays, where we turn bustos into robustos. Brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Rethink poker. And now, your hosts, John Kim and Joe Tehan.
Hey, what's going on, guys? To all the listeners out there, what's going on, Joe?
Hey, what's up, John?
This is Cash Plays on quadjacks.com, brought to you by StackEmCoaching.com. Use promo code quadjacks82 for a free 3-day trial. And I guarantee you that you'll learn plenty over there to improve your poker game and hopefully get you robusto, especially if you're busto. I don't know where that term came from, busto to robusto.
Yeah, I don't quite get it. I mean, I get it, but I've never really used it. I don't like it all that much.
Yeah, I mean, that's just the terminology lingo I saw on 2+2 from guys that, I mean, it happens a lot in the poker world, right, Joe? Guys that go broke, come back, get back on their feet, go broke again. It's like a cycle.
Yeah, I mean, you see it all the time. I've seen it with a lot of guys who just like win big tournaments and they just go up and play like the biggest games in the world and like whatever it is. I mean, guys just always want to play bigger and bigger. You know, it's positive variance and gets to their head a little bit, and they just feel like they're on top of the world. They can beat anything. Yeah, I mean, part of me, I really wish that I had that kind of gamble still in me. I kind of do envy like a lot of like the younger guys who like win a tournament and they just go play in the biggest games. You know, I really do. I kind of wish I had that more so in me. Like when I first started playing, I did, and now it's just
The opposite. That's kind of interesting. I'll just bring it up to people that are listening. You actually went the opposite direction when you won your $1 million in a WPT few years back. When I met you, you're playing 200, 400 limit games. I mean, I dabbled in them too at the time at Bellagio, 100, 200 limit hold'em, stuff like that. And then you win $1 million in a tournament, and then you don't play higher than like 40-80 limit after that.
For a while I did that. I was playing big. Like the night before that tournament started, I had probably my biggest loss ever. It actually was my biggest loss ever. I lost like 36,000 playing a combination that was like 200, 400, and 400, 800, and yeah, it was a bad night, and I remember you had to wake me up the next day and talk me into going to play that tournament. So,
yeah, you should always be forever.
But yeah, like, you know, I'm kind of envious of a lot of the guys who just, you know, they win. So maybe it's me just kind of being a nit. I don't know.
Yeah, well, I was going to ask you, what was your mentality? I mean, most people win $1 million, and you had, like, almost pretty much all your action. You weren't staked at the time, so, I mean, you just won, like, a cool million. What was your mentality after? Like you were saying, most young guys would jump into the biggest no-limit games, 100, 200 NL, 1K, 2K limit games, but instead, you did the exact opposite. It's just kind of, I find it fascinating. It goes against the grain of most poker players.
I mean, poker players are still like human beings, and I guess as a just kind of human nature, you just want to, I mean, my goal in playing poker is to, you know, create, like, be comfortable, like, provide myself and my family with a comfortable living. And I've done that. And, like, but, like, you know, once you get that big score, you're like, whoa, I want to take a step back. Like, I don't want to be gambling for, like, 20, 30,000 every day. Like, and plus it's kind of, you know, it's tough on you mentally. It doesn't matter how much money you have. I mean, you're never really going to have enough money where you're going to go and be comfortable losing like 30,000 in a day. I mean, not many people have that kind of money.
Even if you have $1 million.
Yeah. I mean, and that's when, you know, it's funny because people ask me about tilt and about losing and things like that. And it's like, I'm never going to be happy going and playing and like losing 5K in a day or 10K in a day, whatever it is. Like, I'm never going to be happy about it. And I guess the only time you'll be content with it is like, you know, if my bankroll was like, you know, 20, 30 million, like, I wouldn't mind it. You know, it wouldn't be that big of a deal. But for most people, it's just, you know, I mean, that money, you could have found better things to do with it than lose it on a poker table.
Yeah, I mean, but that's your job, your livelihood. So I'm kind of surprised you didn't. I mean, I can't really say because I'm kind of, I did the same thing. But I mean, I was in a different situation. I mean, I had a family. I have a family. So I, when I won 250K on party poker back then, in a single day in a tournament, I just pretty much invested all of it. Didn't really shot take. So yeah. I mean, I kind of see where you're coming from. But again, like you were single back then. You're young, single. So I just find that little.
I mean, I did play some big. I played some like 6 and 1200 and 4 and 8, like. But yeah, for the most part, I just kind of backed down a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think there's anything wrong with what you did, but I do think one thing, like kids nowadays, they win big and they think they're invincible, and yeah, too many of them end up playing way too big over their head, even with a big score, like a 300, 400K score, and within a year later, they're back to busto.
Yeah, I always think of Tuan Lee. Like he was the man. I mean, he would like win a tournament, and he would just go and play like the biggest games. I mean, he's great. I loved him, you know. But he was a super gambler.
Yeah, there's actually a thread called "Where Are They Now?" It's a pretty popular thread. And his name was mentioned. So the key word you said was where is he now? What's he up to?
I haven't seen him in a while. But I mean, I've seen him like maybe a year ago in L.A. I saw him, and he was still playing in the big games. I don't know if it was his money or someone else's, but, you know, he was still in the games.
Okay. So. All right, well, I guess we covered enough busto to robusto and back and whatever. But, we'll try not to go busto. Hopefully nobody out there listening goes busto. Robusto is a much better spot to be in. But all right, so let's get to some poker stuff, some actual real poker strategy. You've been playing live. I've been grinding online. Well, you just said you started playing live because you're still pretty much a new dad. So that's like a full-time job. I know how it is, especially week one. A lot of restless nights. So I wanted to ask you, what are you playing? PLO, was it? Like 5-5, 5-10?
Yeah, still playing the 5-5 with the straddle PLO game. I love it. It's half high, half low.
I don't think we talk enough PLO. I mean, we cover the ins and outs of No Limit Hold'em, like, to death sometimes, but PLO is a game we don't talk enough about. And next week, we're actually going to have a PLO expert. I think he's a Deuces Crack coach, too. Coaches PLO. Friends with Ben Lamb, really good at PLO. So unfortunately, we don't have him on today, but I wanted to ask you about a recent PLO hand you played. I was going to talk about one I played online, but I think yours is way more interesting. You want to talk about the PLO hand we're talking about? I thought it was pretty fascinating.
Yeah, I just told this hand to John. I just remembered it. I played it like a week or two ago, or like 2 weeks ago. But it was really an interesting hand because it's more of like an idea of trying to accomplish what you want to accomplish. Like, so we were playing PLO high, and I'm under the gun. There was no straddle this hand, which is pretty rare. But anyways, so the blinds are 5-5. And I'm under the gun playing PLO high, and I have ace-ace-3-6 with no suits. So not the greatest PLO hand by any means, but it's still, you know, aces are aces. So I decide to make a min raise. Like, so I just made it $10, just hoping to, you know, build up a pot a little bit. I make it $10 under the gun. Now under the gun plus one makes it $45. And now it goes call, 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 call. And the small blind calls as well. So, like, everyone normally would be thinking this is perfect, but see, if I were to repot it there, like, I was sitting about 4K deep, and most of the guys in middle position all had at least, or somewhere around 2K. You know, and some guys had about 3, 4, 5K, whatever. But so everyone's five, like relatively deep.
So 5-5 blinds. So you guys are all like 400 BBs plus deep.
Yeah. Yeah. Right?
Okay.
Yeah, but I mean, you know, most of the times the game does play with a straddle. So anyways, 5-5. I min raise to 10. Under the Gun plus one makes it 45. You get three callers plus the small blind also calls, and it's back to me. So there's 45 times six in the pot. And if I were to repot there, I'm going to get five callers again or six or whatever it is. I mean, I don't think anyone's going anywhere. Everyone's, so if you repot like I it, said. That,
okay, so there's like five players times 45. So you can put in another 200 to 250 re-raise, right?
I could probably repot to like maybe like 350, I would think, okay. Or three, something like that. Yeah.
And but anyways,
I think if I were to repot, like, and my hand's not really that good. I have no suits or anything. And my other cards aren't very playable. So
I think lesson for, not to interrupt you really quick, but good lesson for no limit players transitioning to PLO is aces is not as cracked up to what it is in PLO that it is in no limit, especially when you have the other two cards aren't working. You always want all four cards working together somehow, or the other cards like suited aces or connectors, ace, ace, nine, ten, stuff like that. But yeah, you have 3-6 off with no suited ace.
And I have no, like, my hand is only good for, like, I don't know, top set value, I guess. Like, it's really not that good.
So this is where the hand gets interesting. I think most people's mentality there, like I said, I would probably just call because my aces are kind of weak. I don't want to blow up the pot. Or some people would think, okay, let me repot it, try to get heads up. Or,
but like some people said, think, yeah, I just have aces, I have to repot, like, you know, and do whatever I... And now they're going to get in very, very awkward situations where they, you know, they're another 1,800 behind or 1,700 behind or even deeper in spots where, you know, I mean, you're never really going to know, like, where you're at. Or you can get it in, you know, behind to, like, much better draws or whatever. Like, so the hand's going to be, like, very tough to play unless you flop
a set. Pretty much aces, you have to tread the waters carefully in PLO, especially out of position, especially deep. Okay, so what did you end up doing? Which I thought this was pretty cool.
So it was 10:45. Everyone calls, and it comes back to me. And I could just call, but I decided I min re-raised to 85. Or 35 more, so I made it 80. Just hoping to, like, reopen the door in case anyone does want to spaz out or in case, you know, I mean, I still do have aces, so I still am trying to, hopefully I can get a lot of money in preflop. And again, if everyone just calls 80, oh well, I'm probably going to have to check fold the flop anyways. Like, my hand's not very good, but I'm giving everyone a chance to, like, possibly spaz out. You know, they might see a lot of dead money in there and they might, like, do something preflop. So
yeah, I mean, if they have a hand like 7, 8, 9, 10, a guy might just decide to try to pick up all the dead money out there. And even if called, he knows his hand plays fairly well. Or if guy has queens or kings, you know.
So that's what happened. I min re-raised to 85 and now it goes call again. And now the small blind, the last caller, he now pots it to, like, 500 something or whatever it was, I think it was 490 more maybe or something like that. He potted it and, you know, it comes back to me. And now I can, like, get in a lot of money preflop with aces, which was the goal. So now I can repot up to, like, 1,800 or something. Or I repotted to, like, 1,700. Now everyone else got out of the way. And the guy ended up calling. He had double-suited kings. He had, like, maybe single-suited kings. It was, like, king, 6-7 or something. And, you know, that was the interesting part of the hand. The rest of the hand, we had, like, 2,500 left. And he had king, 6-7. The flop comes 7-5-4. And I had ace-ace-6-3, so
you end up pretty convenient. My
useless 6-3 ended up playing pretty well in that hand.
Right. Well, I mean, I was saying you want cards that work together, even though 6-3 is not really working together. But I mean, it's still a little bit of potential. I thought that was pretty fascinating that you took, like, the outside the box approach and min 3-bet to open up the betting. Yeah. And then you got exactly what you wanted, and the guy ended up potting it. And that's what you want to do with aces.
Yeah, but still, I mean, I think the important part to mention is, like, even after I re-raised to 80, I'm still planning on check folding most flops. Like, I'm still not really planning on doing anything crazy unless I flop pretty big, especially in a 5 or 6 way action pop. But luckily, I did get a heads up. And, you know, that is the goal in PLO. I mean, if you can get it all in pre-flop with ace-ace.
Oh, yeah, with aces, yeah. Even if you have aces and, like, 3-6 off, I mean, I think there's a few spots where you're a very small underdog, like 52, 48 maybe. I think a guy says 7, 8, 9, 10 double suited. You might be a small dog, very small. But with all that dead money in, it's plus EV, no matter what. Any hand, if you can get a heads up against any four-card combination with all that dead money in, aces with anything, it's got to be a plus EV spot. And that's exactly what you accomplished, no matter what the results were.
But someone in the chat asked, what's the best starting hand in PLO high?
That's debatable. It's between two hands.
Yeah, I heard two different things. Ace-ace, king-king, double-suited, or ace-ace, jack-ten, double-suited.
Yeah, those are they're pretty much interchangeable, but those are the top two hands. It's not 7-8-9-10, contrary to what some people might think. 7-8-9-10 has a lot of playability post-flop, and it matches up well against overpairs, but in terms of, like, overall favorite pre-flop, ace-ace, king-king, or ace-ace, jack-10, double-suited are right at the top two.
Another important thing to mention, I think, in PLO, I just kind of started playing it recently, but you'll see a lot more things that you'd almost never see in hold'em. Like, people think, oh, well, I can't call off half my stack, or I can't, like, do, and you know what I mean? Where in hold'em, usually... Yeah, you can't call off half your stack. I mean, you're almost always going to have to go with it.
I said if you put in at least over 20, like 30% or more of your stack pre, you should be getting it all in pretty much. It's a mistake to call off 30% or more and then fold pre-flop.
But PLO, I know what you're getting at. I think it's different.
It is completely different in PLO.
No, I think it's different. Like, if you're in a tournament and you have, like, 10 big blinds and someone 3x's it, like, it's okay to call off 30% of your stack there. If you know, like, the guy's never going to fold pre-flop. Like, I think that's okay to call there because, now it gives you, like, an extra chance to do something with your remaining chips. I don't think that's all that bad. I mean, people, like... always think, you know, oh, well, if I can't just call, I have to get it in. And people always say that. And it's like, why? Like, why do you have to get it in? And even in tournaments, I don't think, I mean, what do you think about that, John? I mean, like.
Don't ask me for tournament advice. You're the tournament expert. So,
no,
I mean, I know in PLO cash games, and I've been actually working on my PLO cash game. I've been watching, like, Brian Hastings' PLO videos and some other guy at top high stakes players PLO videos of recent. And I see him putting in like 30-40% of their stacks pre-flop and then folding. And they say in PLO and they're saying that's fine. Unlike no limit hold'em. You know, you can hit a lot of flops in PLO. Like, you know, like you can put in 35-40% of your stack with a hand like 6-7-8-9 and then just fold if you don't hit anything. I mean I agree with you. In tournaments where survival is so essential, why would you just like stick it all in? With, you know, like a marginal to fair holding.
Yeah.
Why not see a flop? And if you completely whiff, save your remaining 60%, 70% of your stack.
Even you can call 60% of your stack pre-flop and then just, I mean, you know, the board can come queen, deuce, deuce, and like you have 6, 7, 8, 9 double suited or something. Like, I always suggest, you know, save the rest of those chips. If they don't do anything for you pre-flop, if they don't give you any, like, fold equity, you're never going to, like, fold the guy. Like, save those chips. They, you know, they might be useful post-flop or, you know, anything like that. And I kind of suggest the same thing in No Limit, but not nearly as much as PLO. PLO, it's like, essential to do that.
Yeah, a lot of it's just flop-based. You have to connect. Like, in No Limit, even if you don't hit the flop, you can still end up outdrawing someone. PLO, if you don't hit the flop, it's much harder to outdraw someone. Yeah, like you said, 6, 7, 8, 9 on a queen, deuce, deuce.
Let's talk about some of these other hands. You just sent me this PLO hand.
Let's skip that. Let's get to my no limit hand really quick. Your PLO hand is way more interesting. It just
okay.
But this first no limit hand, it's funny because you asked me, what did this guy show you? Like, did you see what the guy had? Well, yeah,
I read this hand. I don't know what the guy showed on the river.
Okay, so this is a 3-6 online hand, no limit, 6 max games. I'm sitting 700 deep, so about 120 BBs deep. Cut off with 1,000 opens to $18. He's just like a standard reg. I call with kings on the button. But here's the interesting thing. In any poker, if there's like a bad player, you usually kind of want to bring him along. I mean, it shouldn't drive all the actions, all your decisions, but you definitely want to factor it. The reason why I flatted, and this is actually, it's not a standard flat, obviously. I should always be three. I don't want to say always, but normally you want a three bet kings on the button against the cutoff opener. But I flatted because the small blind, who I thought was somewhat of a, actually he was a fish. His stats were 63, 26, 15. For people that don't know what that means, he was seeing 63% of flops. His opening raise percentage was 26%, and his 3-bet percentage was 16%. And Joe, I mean, I know you've dabbled in online, but you're not as versed as I am. And you can even see those are like really super massive whale stats, right? So I didn't want to 3-bet and blow this guy out. And he was sitting 1-2.
Yeah, I was going to say, I can't remember the last time I've ever just flatted a button on or a raise on the button with kings. Like, I don't do it, especially from the cutoff open. Just because cutoff opens like, relentlessly.
No, I do. So do I. I have a super wide range when I 3-bet the cutoff open. But I felt like the small blind, he won't be able to help himself. And he's going to squeeze like 80% of the time here. When he sees a cutoff and button money, he just can't help himself with the 16% 3-bet percentage. He's going to squeeze an abnormally high amount of time. So I just flatted and I thought, hopefully this guy squeezes. And right on cue, he 3-bets to $42, the small blind. So everyone else got out of the way, and I'm like, okay, perfect. This is going according to plan. And I 4-bet to 110. And he called because that's, he's got a 63% chance of calling. That's his VPIP. And the flop comes pretty good. I think 10-10-8, rainbow, a heart, spade, and a diamond. There's $268 in the pot. I mean, what a great spot. I'm in position with kings against a guy playing 60% of his range in a 4-bet pot, and we're sitting fairly deep. He checks, and I bet 100 into a $268 pot. Again, like a lesson here is the drier the flop, the less you can bet, and you kind of want to string him along. That's what I was thinking. He calls, turns a 5 of spade, kind of a blank, bringing backdoor spades. There's 468 in the pot. I bet 185. We have like 300 left behind. He calls, my bet sizing was pretty good, I think. On the river, there's $838 with 300 back. So I think he has to call almost any kind of like made hand. He's getting too good of a price. So on the river comes an 8, so the board is 10-10, 8, 5, 8, no flush draw. I mean, a little bit of, because I don't think he ever has a 10. I think he's check shoving the turn or check raising the flop with the 10. And I don't see many eights in his range. I'm thinking like he has like ace high, like ace queen or queen jack or pocket nines, pocket
queen
jacks.
Queen jack, maybe.
Yeah, that's what I said, queen jack. Maybe nine, 6-7, a bunch of hands. So I think I have to shove for value here. What do you think? I mean, is this too thin? Shoving on a 10-10, 8-8-5 board?
I mean, too thin. The guy just check called the entire way. And you have kings.
I think this is an auto shove.
I think an important lesson too is people are afraid to get like that last bit of value. Like if you have 300 left and there's 800 in the pot, like, and you have an overpair and the guy's not betting your last 300, like you should almost always bet it. Even if like a four flush comes or whatever it is. I mean, no matter how scary the board is, if you only have 300 left and the guy didn't put you in when there's already 800 in the pot, like you almost, you're going to have the best hand there always. You know, even if the board runs out, very scary. Like,
okay, so I shoved 300 and you asked me, wow, like, did you see what his hand was after like he mucked? And I'm like, yeah, because the freaking pot went to him. That's how I saw his head. I didn't win the damn pot. I saw his hand.
The best hand. You're not. I guess you don't always have the best hand. Maybe not always.
I mean, yeah, I saw his hand when the money was going to him. That's how I saw his hand. Freaking out when you asked me, like, did you check his hand after he called and his hand got mucked? I'm like, yeah, because I didn't win the hand. He had Jack Gate of Spades. So, which is pretty brutal. Like, he flopped an eight, turned a flush draw, and then rivered eight full. So, I mean, I guess that's the line he should take with the hand. But the reason. Yeah, a couple of points I wanted to make is sometimes, like, you can set up plays or players, like pre-flop, which I did. I just, you know, everything went according to what, I mean, the end result wasn't good, but. I mean, people can just say, oh, had you 3-bet net, you wouldn't have lost 800-700 or whatever. The guy might have folded. But yeah, that's just being results-oriented. I mean, I got my money in good pretty much. Like, I got the situation I wanted. He's not going to hit his whatever 10-out or whatever going into the river. On the flop, he only had 2 outs going to the turn. Picked up more equity. But most time, I want to be in that spot. So can't be results-oriented.
Yeah, and hey, I guess I retract my comment a little bit, but still, I mean, you know, once he makes his full house, he should definitely put you all in on the river once the eight comes. He can't just expect you to bet. And, you know, you're, like, calling almost always, even with, like, ace high hands or anything.
That's true.
So he should always put you all in on the river. But, yeah, like, that's right. Why you should bet the kings. I mean... for value, obviously.
I knew that was a fairly standard value bet on my end. I just thought he might hero call with ace high there sometimes, like ace nine, or you turn the flush draw on the turn, or ace queen. But okay, let's. That was my weekly bad beat. That'd be end of the week. So, but let's bring on Austin to Crispy Schaff. I want to discuss some more internet poker with him. He's an internet pro. We'll bring him on right after this commercial.
Austin, what's up, man?
All right,
man?
So today we have Austin Schaff, aka to Crispy Original G, Michigan
what's going on,
alum.
Guys?
So,
yeah, what's going on, Austin?
Okay, good. Austin has been
not too much.
Just a quick intro for Austin. He's one of our original proteges, Joe and mine, for live poker at our StackEm site. Also, he's been a longtime internet grinder, did well in the UB days. I want to ask you that crazy story you had about UB. Do you remember this, Joe, when Austin was talking about cashing out? He's going to move up to Canada to just cash out his UB money.
In like 500 a week or something?
That's where you grinded most of your online play, right?
Yeah, unfortunately.
Is that where most of your internet money was on UB?
Yeah, unfortunately, I had basically my entire role on UB. I had, like, just a little bit on Full Tilt, which I'm not really worried about, but I had, like, 15 stuck on UB, and I actually remember on Black Friday, kids were talking about, like, selling their UB money, and it was going at, like, 65 cents on the dollar, but U.S., people couldn't, like, get onto their account and, like, transfer. And I was like, okay, I'm going to move to Canada, and as soon as I do, I'm going to sell it at 65 cents on the dollar. Like, I don't care if I lose a couple K, like, whatever. Like, I just want most of my roll. And then, like, some news came out, and it dropped to, like, 20 cents and 10 cents on the dollar, and then they, like, started limiting cash outs to 500, like, every other week, and then it dropped down to 250, and... I'm pretty sure I still have 2 pending cash outs that just never went through, and I don't know if you've heard anything recently. I haven't heard anything. I'm just assuming the money's gone.
That's horrible, man.
Yeah,
I haven't heard anything about UB.
Yeah, that's brutal. I mean,
I'm excited.
I think
for
you're
the
almost drawing
community
with
this.
UB.
Like,
at least if you have.
What was that? I'm sorry.
What's that, John?
The Full Tilt thing.
Yeah, I'm excited, for the entire
poker. If you have money on Full Tilt, at least you have some kind of semblance chance.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like,
yeah,
I hope everyone else gets their money.
It sucks here on UB. So you didn't end up moving to Canada after all?
No, I did.
I guess the lesson here was never play on UB.
Yeah.
Oh, you did go up to Canada.
Yeah, I went up to Canada. Like
500 a week.
Yeah. Did that and then came to Vegas for the summer.
How are you even coming out ahead? You're cashing out 500 a week, but the cost of living up there is going to be more.
Well, the main reason I did that is to like get.
So you're going up there
to like establish residency and like get all my bank account and money bookers and all that stuff set up so I could keep grinding. And that went well. And
okay, yeah. So.
John, are you there?
You, so you're in the Michigan area.
I am. Right,
where
I am
exactly
right
did you go when you went to Canada?
I went up to Vancouver.
Yeah, I'm here.
Okay.
Yeah, your audio's okay. Kind of cut out.
Oh, okay. I guess I'm having a little bit of audio problem. Okay, Joe. You got any internet questions for him? Since I'll try to fix my audio in the meantime.
Okay. Yeah. Well, we've been Austin was like our first student. What were we gonna do? Talk some hands with Austin, right? Let's see here.
Yeah. First of all, Austin. All right. Well, Austin, am I back? Can you guys hear me?
Yeah. Yeah. That's
better now.
Can you guys? Okay. So, are you going to med school, Austin?
Yeah, so once upon a time before I discovered poker, like I discovered poker in my senior year of college. And up until that point, I was a pre-med student and was planning on going to medical school. And then I took 1 year off to play online poker for a living. That's turned into 3 years now. But like with Black Friday and with everything else that's happened, it just seems like the right move right now to go back to school. Like I always knew it was something I was eventually going to want to do, but with all the stuff happening with online poker, it just seems like the perfect time to go back to school. So
that was the one thing we always like when we were working with Austin in the beginning. We told him, poker's great and it is what it is. You can make pretty good money at it, but like. It's always going to be there. Like if you're working with school, like I finished up and got my degree and I think, you should get your degree and
you have your master's.
You can always
right?
go back. Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
Yep. So,
yeah. So I think I see a lot of kids nowadays that used to grind online because of Black Friday. If they didn't want to relocate, they're going back to school and I'm all for that. I mean, I think education is very important. So,
I mean, it's not
guys.
Only the relocation, but I think I'm not the only one to say this, that in general the games have just gotten much tougher post Black Friday. It's just a lot reggier, I don't know. Maybe I was just spoiled on like back in the UB days, but there was always just like massive fish at the table. Like game selection was just very easy to do, and now it's like, you'll have 20 tables open and like two might be good or three might be good. Like I don't mean to discourage anyone from playing online, but I don't know. It's definitely not like how it used to be, that's for sure. And I only started back in like 09. I can only imagine what it was like back in, 04, 05, 06, like back in the party poker golden days.
It was as good as you think it would be.
It was, yeah. Yeah, it was great, Austin. I'm pretty much living off the profits from back then.
Oh, jeez, way to rub it in. I appreciate that.
All my money was from like 2005, 2006. So,
yeah.
You covered exactly what I was going to ask you, what you thought the current state of games was like, since I know you've been still dabbling online, right? Waiting to start med school.
Yeah, I've been dabbling a little bit. I know like right after the summer, I ran kind of deep in the main event and had a little bit of money and put some of it on party poker. And like instantly in my first 10K hands, I probably made like 8 or 9K at like 1, 2, and 2, 4. And I was like, oh, online's easy. And like nothing happened. Black Friday, what was that? And then I don't know. Like obviously that was just an unsustainable heater. And I kind of like came back to reality. And I don't know. It's just a... It's a much like tougher scene nowadays.
Yeah.
Yeah, I agree with you. I tell Joe, like I'm playing on Merge and stuff like that, and freaking the games are tough nowadays. We just need to get legislation passed so we can get all the American fish back.
Yeah, it's just it's too tough for the fish to play. So like, it's just going to be all the online pros who like will jump through hoops to keep playing, and they're just going to play against each other, and it's not going to be profitable.
Like, I mean, Stars might be okay. I mean, we wouldn't know since we live in the States, but yeah. Stars still has a pretty big amount of games. And I don't know, Joe, have you heard like Stars is going to buy Full Tilt?
So that I heard about that.
Yeah, Full Tilt's player base, and who knows, maybe that'll open up some doors.
That was some pretty exciting news. Like if the word UB was thrown in there, like Stars is going to buy Full Tilt and UB, I would have been the happiest guy ever, but that was not the case. So
no one's gonna touch UB. Are you kidding?
Yeah, no, definitely
like
not.
The touch of death. Or,
yeah.
All right. So let's.
Okay.
Yeah. Like,
since we have Austin here, I have some internet hands I played, and I want to get your expert opinion. Since
when we started working with Austin, like Austin kind of plays kind of the way he like, you know, the way you would think he would play, right? He's 21, like knows everything there is to know about poker. He occasionally gets caught up. I don't know. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I think he occasionally gets caught up in like some maybe fancy play syndrome every once in a while. Like sometimes you just and I think everyone goes through this where you just think you're too good. You think you're better than you really are. And like I go through the same thing. Like I think, well, I can beat this guy and it doesn't matter what my hand is, you know?
Yeah, I definitely went through a phase, especially like when I was starting to play live. Like since I would have so much time like playing each hand and like in between hands, I would just think of like the coolest, most interesting ways to play a hand, which isn't necessarily the most profitable way. Like sometimes you just have to play it like very face up and very boring, and that's what makes you money. And I don't know, maybe I'm just
exactly.
I just can't like focus, but yeah.
So that's a little preface.
Yeah,
to,
you're. Before we I was gonna say yeah. I know. I was gonna say Austin, you're like such the prototypical internet guy. When you were playing live cash game, just come on and think you can outplay everybody and take like the unoptimal line or, you know, just like the non-standard line just to like outplay everybody.
Like
how'd that end up for
stuff
you?
Like that, which doesn't really matter. Yeah.
So, but yeah, it's just funny. You just think like since you're a pretty successful internet cash game player, you just think you can just outplay everybody. Alive, but this is a dangerous trap to fall into. So Joe's pretty much saying sometimes you get caught up with the little fancy place syndrome. But okay, here's some internet hands I want to talk to you about that I played recently. You know, I like going over hands. Joe likes dissecting hands, but let's just get right to it. The first hand I was playing yesterday, my brother was sweating me. He's not a poker player. He's just in town. Mm-hmm. He hasn't really watched me play much, but he's just, you know, bored and check out the action. So I get involved in this hand. This is 2-4, and I'm playing anywhere from 1-2 to 3-6. So I've got tables of various sizes.
Okay.
And just like most American grinders, I can't play too high because we don't know. When our account's going to get freeze, whatever account length too much. So I'm not playing as high as I normally would. But still, this 2-4 is fairly high. You can still go on big swings. I have king-jack off in the big blind and cutoff. I mean, I kind of just sat down, so I don't know. But I kind of felt like cutoff was kind of splashy, fishy, just from a few hands I was observing. Mm-hmm. He opens to 12. We're all like $400, $500 deep, so 100 BBs. Button calls, and I have my HUD open. And the button's running at 18-14-4. So you know that's pretty nitty, right?
In a okay, six max. Yeah. Uh-huh.
So 18-14. Like a standard reg would be like 22-20, VPIP 22, PFR 20-19, 3-bet 7 or 8. This guy's at 18-14-4. And obviously I want to hear what Joe will do here too. He calls 12, and I 3-bet to 50 with king-jack off in the big blind. Which is, you know, whatever, it's fine. I can make a case for flatting there too. Yeah, I can flat also, but both guys call 38 more. There's $152 in the pot. The flop comes king, queen, jack, rainbow. Seems like a good flop. I bet 100. Yeah, I bet 100. Cutoff goes all in for 600. Button cold calls all in for 372.
What
do I do with kings and jacks? Yeah, that's what I said.
The cutoff went all in for
600. The button cold calls all in for 372. and it's another 260 more back to me.
Oh, the comp went in for 650, it looks like.
Wait, what stats did you have on the cutoff? Like you said you thought he was fishy, but
he's fishy, so I only had a few hands. So.
Yeah, I don't think this is even close. Like, I would call 100% of the time.
It's a call, but I'm more curious as to like what the hell the button has.
Yeah, the button's got you beat like almost. Yeah. The button's got you beat almost always. I don't know about almost always. The button's got you beat a lot. The button's got you beat a lot.
Calling then. If the buttons got me like almost always. The guy's 18-14. He's 18 flop. He code calls all in on a king queen jack rainbow flop.
Okay, I mean, I think we're having a little bit of technical difficulties, but
we'll bring on Austin. Don't worry, but yeah, he even just said like the button almost always has me beat. So why is this an easy call?
Because you're still gonna like. Beat the other guy. Like, the other guy's shoving, like, with nothing. I mean, the guy's got a pair plus straight draw or pair plus flush draw. All
right. What are we beating in the buttons range? 18% is very low for 6 mag. That's, like, the tightest of ranges. And then, like, this is a 3-bet pot pre. And he's, like, a standard thinking reg. It's not like he's just clicking buttons. So.
I mean. Okay, so. What are we beating? Not much.
Yeah, name a hand we're beating in the buttons range. The cutoff, this is my thoughts. The cutoff, I'm ahead of his range. No big deal. I get it all in. But once the button calls, like, what am I beating in the buttons range? Let's go over his hands. He doesn't have pocket queens, pocket king. He probably doesn't have pocket jacks. I think he, like, back 5-bet shoves.
Yeah, he doesn't have any set. I don't think he would have a set. I don't think he has ace king.
He never has a hand with the 10. He's not calling 370 cold with an open and straight draw. He's not. You know, he's a reg. He's a standard reg. No one's calling. No regs are calling with just an open ender. That's basically what he has. It doesn't matter what his pair is because his pair is never any good against my hand or
okay.
Like,
well,
guy's show.
We lost Austin here, but. But I still want to talk to you about this hand. Like, you can't just say he's never has any of those hands. I mean, like.
Yeah, I don't think he never has those hands. I don't think any competent reg is calling 372, like almost 100 BBs cold with just an open ender on a king, queen, jack, and a 3-bet pot. Because he knows, like, he's probably up against ace, king. Aces sets a lot, like my range and the other guy's range, where even if he has a pair, his pair has almost no, a little bit of value, but not enough. So he's just relying on his open and straight draw. He's calling, you know, like getting 2-to-1, calling.
So what hands are you saying that the button has? Ace 10, 10-9?
9, queen jack, king jack, king queen are all within his range. I think that's okay. the hands. And we're beating one. Queen jack.
All right, I'm back.
All right, we got Austin back. Good.
Okay, was that a fair range to assign? Like, Austin, why are you... The competent reg running at 18-14 never is cold calling a shove for $372 with, like, king 10, queen 10. He's just going to fold those hands. Do you agree with that?
Yes.
I think we can maybe put King 10 in his range as well. But that's the only other hand.
I disagree. I don't even think he's calling preflop with King 10. A guy playing 18-14 is not calling a raise with King 10, not especially not a 3-bet. He may with the fish in.
Okay. So he has 10-9, ace 10, king jack, queen jack, and king queen.
Right.
Okay, so like
beating queen jack, that's it, and we're losing to everything
else. Is there any way that he could
there's a flush draw, then yeah, obviously there's more hands in his range that he can be calling with, like a pair and a flush draw, combo draw, stuff like that. But it's king, queen, jack, rainbow, so you guys are both saying you would call.
Yeah, this might be kind of a specific stat to ask for, but Like, maybe he could be someone that just 3-bets out of the blinds and for some reason never 3-bets on the button. But assuming that he has a 4% 3-betting range from the button, then I would assume we could, like, eliminate all, like, sets, and I would hope ace-king as well from his range.
I already said that. We already agreed on that. We're eliminating. Okay. Like I said, I don't know if you heard. This is his range of hands. Is king-queen, king-jack, queen-jack, ace-10, 9-10. I think that's pretty much it. Because we all agreed he's never cold calling $372 at 2-4 with any 10x hand, even if it's king-10. Like, what Rick does.
Okay, right?
I would never call. Austin, you would never call, right?
Nope.
Like, 90 BBs cold with, like, top pair open and straight draw.
Okay, but... I think our range against the guy who shoved for, like, $700 or $650 is, like,
important. Like, it doesn't matter he shoved for... The effective stacks are 400. I didn't have 600. The guy...
Other guy covered.
No, I only had $433 start the hand. Button had 400.
Oh, all right. Yeah. You have to fold then. You have to fold.
Yeah.
I thought you had 700.
No, I have 433. Button had 422. Yeah, the fish had 700.
So wait, on the flop, you led. Fish shoved.
I led 100. Fish shoved for, let's say, 280. For 300 effective, so it's another 200. Oh, no, I'm sorry, because I raised like another 260 effective, because I raised to 50 pre. 270, 260. Button cold calls all in for 372. And then it's up to me. I have to call 260, 270 more.
To win, like...
A whole bunch.
I mean, you got to call that to win, like, almost... 1,200, right? I mean,
yeah.
I'm winning 800 plus another. No, it's 250 to win like 950, 270 to win like close to 1,000. So I'm getting like 4-1 on my call. But my point is, like, I know we're ahead of the cutoff shoving range because that guy's kind of a donkey. But I'm saying the nitty reg on the button, like, what are we ahead of when he cold calls like a huge shove? Like 372. That's like 100 BBs, pretty much. He's just cold calling.
All right. Well, first of all, like, this is the, I don't know. I think this is kind of important, like, for a lot of people. Like, and you obviously know this, but when you say, what am I ahead of? It doesn't matter what you're ahead of. You don't have to be ahead of anything. You just have to, you know, you don't have to be winning at the time. You know what I mean? You just have to have more than like 20. All you have to have is more than like 25% equity there to call. I mean,
or like 20, yeah.
To call profitably.
I guess. I just felt like I'm drawing so to 4 out. So I didn't feel like I had 25% equity. So.
Okay, that's different. It's not like what am I beating or what am I ahead of?
I think this is close. If we use combinatorics and just assign like the 5 hands we gave him. All straights, all 2-pair combinations hands. We probably have a total of maybe like 5.5 outs against his range, something like that, right? Then I don't think we have enough equity to call. I don't think we have the 25% that I need getting 4-1, right?
Yeah, although at the time, like if I'm like 6 or 8 tabling and this just happens, I don't know if I don't know if I think that's of this. I'm probably just like, I have 2-pair. I just like get it in. But
I should change my initial. My initial statement was auto call, but I thought the guy shoved for 700, and you had him.
It's 430 effective pre. So, but anyways, yeah. I mean, I'm a caller too. I'm like a station when I play. I don't fold online. Joe's seen it. Like they have to show me a better hand.
Yeah.
But especially in 3-bet pots, if I flop 2-pair, I'm never folding. Like pretty much always. But here I'm just like.
Well, yeah. Once you break it down, like that knit really can't have anything.
All right, but I'm gonna be embarrassed, and you guys are gonna be all over me. I know this is like I hate the ending because I ended up tank folding.
The worst part is if the button does have queen jack, is that one time.
you think what I didn't you know where I was going with this? Like the Schaff shows King 7 off. I mean, we had him pegged down. It was like we're always ahead of him, usually ahead. And the button had Queen Jack. So yeah. and I would tripled whatever. I would have won $800, and I mean that's being results oriented. But like I said, that's like the only hand we're ahead of. He's gonna have King Queen, King Jack, Ace 10, 9 10 there also.
Although I don't know, can he even have Ace 10?
Ace 10 suited, Ace 10 suited for sure.
Really?
For sure, yeah. Yeah. If he has Queen Jack suited, why can't he have Ace 10 suited?
So I mean I'm not full
Queen Jack can make more straights. Sorry.
I mean, you're in position against a fish. You're going to have both hands. He's going to have both hands in his range.
I guess.
So, so whatever. If I don't be results oriented, I can say, well, way to go, guys. You guys are right. I was wrong. Whatever. Blah, blah, blah. But I still felt like I made the right fold. Like the only hand I beat is Queen Jack there. And just being results oriented. But whatever. I kind of felt sick when I saw that. Just like my brother was like, why are you folding? Because he doesn't understand. Like, you have the best hand. Why are you folding?
Even your brother gets it, and you don't, JK. It doesn't seem... Your brother, who's never played poker, even he gets it. Wow, you don't flop two pair very often. get it in.
Just like when he sees the hand, he's like, you have the best hand. Why did you fold? Like, he sees the Queen Jack and King 7, and I'm like, well, because I thought this guy always has better most of the time. So, but...
Two things I'd like to say. One, I said I would insta call, but I thought the guy had sick. You had him covered, and the money you're going to win from him in the side pot, regardless of even if you only have 20% equity or whatever in the main pot, you're probably a big favorite in the side pot. Especially, you know, if he has King 7,
right?
You know,
I was misunderstanding on your part. You thought I had extra money against.
I don't know what I would do in that situation. And secondly. I mean, who knows? Yeah, I think the other point is like, you don't have to be ahead, but you just have to be getting the right price. I mean, you can be a 3-1 dog, but getting 4-1 on your money, and you still have to gamble.
Right. I agree.
That's an important lesson for like a lot of people to learn, though.
Yeah, I agree. So, Austin, I just want to ask you like, when you multi-table, you said this before, you don't really break down all the math and stuff. Is it just more feel-based?
Well, okay, I don't want to go so far as to say I'm just like a feel-based player, but like...
Yeah, that's insulting, Jake.
Yeah. Well,
I play on feel.
Right, internet guy.
I mean,
but there's a decent amount of truth to that, especially when you're 10-tabling, 8-tabling, stuff like that. Like you said, you don't have the time to like write all this down, like how we just broke it down, combinations and equities and stuff.
Like a lot of times what I'll do is I'll just, like after the hand happens, I'll mark it in my software and just like review it later. But like at the time, I don't know if I would like be able to break down the button's range that extensively. Like I would just probably assume like, okay, he probably has ace king and ace queen or something crazy here, or like king 10, even if he might not. So I feel like I would almost like assign his range such that I can call him. Like I would be more biased. I would give him a wider range than he probably actually has just because there's other stuff going on and I have maybe like 3 seconds to make this decision. So I'd be like,
So you're looking for reasons to call.
Yeah. I have a pair in a 3-bet pot, multi-way. I'm getting like a bajillion to one. He probably has a wide range. I call. It's probably what would go through my head at the time.
Plus it's online.
Everyone's
plus it's online. Everyone's bluffing. Everyone understands ranges.
Anything over 3-1 is like 1 in my head.
That's true.
Yeah. Well, I mean, I was getting through 4-1 on this call, and I guess you guys would have snap called and been right. But whatever. It was just being results oriented. I want to actually touch up on one more hand before we wrap up. I thought this is hand. This is deeper stacks. This is 3-6. I want the turn play is interesting here. It's a the 3-6 hand, I'll just say it really quick. And this is deep stack poker is pretty freaking hard when you're really sitting really deep, 200 BBs deep, especially against like good online players. So even live, it's hard when you're... I mean, Joe has a lot of experience playing really deep, so he may know how to play this hand better than I did. I think I screwed this hand up. So we're just bashing my play today. That's pretty much what it is. Okay, so under the gun raises to $18. This is 6 max. We're playing 3-6. He has $850. I have $1,800, so I'm running pretty well. He's running at 30-27-17, which is pretty high. And I'm right behind him with 2 queens. You can make a case for 3-betting. Flatting is fine, too, I think. 3-betting is probably the standard choice. But it's kind of awkward. I don't want to get in, like, $850. How many BBs is that? Like, 140 BBs pre with queens against under-the-guns range, right? I don't think it's a pretty good spot. So I just flatted. And there was this fish in the small blind. But I think it was more because of our stack size. It's kind of weird. I flatted. Everyone folds. The flop comes 8-4 deuce with 2 diamonds. I don't have a diamond in my hands. I have the queen of spades, queen of hearts. He bets $28 into a $45 pot. I call, turns a 10 of diamonds, so there's 3 diamonds. There's $100 in the pot. He bets $67. This is where I take like a kind of unorthodox line, and probably a bad line too. I make it 142 just to like kind of set up, just kind of set up my shell down because I don't want him bombing like 180, like 200 or 250, and I'm like, what do I do? Like, and plus, you know, if a diamond rolls off on the river, he could bluff me off queens easily. So I make it 142, and he tanks and makes it 340, and I fold. So
yeah, I was just about to say when you told me you raised, like, especially if he's a 30-27, I feel like he's more likely, like, he definitely could be spazzing with like ace X with the ace of diamonds there.
Yeah, he could spaz with a lot when you raise.
Yeah, he could. I don't know. Maybe he is. I mean, I hated my line here, but my question is, like, do you guys, what do you think of, like, raising the turn to kind of, like, charge their draws and then setting up your own shell down in position? I mean, it's usually a play I don't advocate. There's actually a term for it, which I found out. It's called the freeze play. Basically, like raising turn in position with the weak to moderate shell down hand in order to take the lead, freeze the out of position opponent, and check behind the river. That's basically the definition of it.
Okay. I've never heard that term before, but I like it.
Yeah, and I wrote down some more notes. It's not necessarily the best play because a good opponent can jam over it, putting you in a wretched spot. And you're often shutting down potential dirty barrels that you can profitably call. Mm-hmm. And forcing your opponent to only continue with hands that beat you when you raise. But it's okay. It's good to freeze people when you have no idea what the river tendencies of your opponent are. And it's much cheaper than calling the river. So like I said, had I called here, now he bombs like 250 or 200 on the river. What do I do? Like if the river's a blank.
I mean he could close your eyes and call, but...
Yeah.
it's not the greatest spot, but I don't know. I'd probably prefer that play more if he was maybe a little nittier. If I didn't think he had any like spash potential in him, but if he's playing a 30-27,
it's just call. I think against like a good tough player like that. That's what I would say is call.
I mean, certain rivers we would fold, like a diamond river. The reason why I did it, I was just thinking, like, he could have, like, a random diamond, and I want to charge him, and, you know, like, and I don't want to get buffed off if a diamond did roll off. I just kind of want to set up my shell down price myself, and we're deep, too.
Like, I do. I like doing that. The freeze play, it's not something like... I don't know. You don't see it very often, it's helpful in spots like this. It's more so in spots like against decent like good opponents that you're very deep and I think this is like and it's kind of important when you're very deep with someone and like on the flop or something if someone was going to like bet and you have like top pair, but like in, let's say a hand like 8-9 and the flop comes like, you know, 3-4-8. And you're against like a really good opponent and you're very deep. Like those are spots I don't mind just raising on the flop and just kind of ending it. Like, you're just kind of trying to, especially against opponents who you know are going to constantly barrel against you and put you in, like, really tough situations. I don't mind, like, just taking away control of the pot from him there on the flop. On the turn, like, yeah, it's the same thing. I mean, you kind of price your own showdown. But, yeah, and, like, in a spot like this, I don't know. It doesn't seem like...
So you guys
I don't
like
mind it. I don't mind it. I really don't mind it.
Bets, we have to fold to a 3-bet. He makes it 340 after I make it 140. We'll just have to fold.
Or do we call?
I mean, I don't know. Just
yeah,
like,
you don't have
whatever.
A diamond, do you?
No. That's why if I have a diamond, I'm just calling the turn because I have redraw outs. But I don't have a diamond. That's why I was more inclined to do this stupid freeze play. But I usually think it's bad. I think, like what Joe said, there's some merit to it when you're much deeper, because especially against an aggressive player where he puts you to tough decisions later on, it's just to try to kind of like define hands early on and save money. I mean, normally we don't want to make plays to like know where we stand, but I think when we're really deep and the guy's aggro, I can see the merit to that. But here we're like 145 BBs deep. It's not like super deep, but I don't know. I'm just like, I hate raise folding and overpair, not seeing like, and when a guy 3-bet, it's just because I'm turning my hand into a bluff pretty much. And I tell everybody, don't ever do that. And then, you know, I do it myself, right? So,
I don't think there's anything wrong with it.
It would be my first option, but I guess in some situations it's.
Have you ever done the freeze play, Austin?
I mean, I didn't know of the term freeze play until just right now.
Looked it up. It was just online, so
I want to ask Austin about that queen nine hand.
Queen nine.
All right, we're running short on time, but we'll get it. And I don't think. The guy that quad jacks, whatever. All right,
Okay, this is a brief hand I want to ask Austin about. So it's like five-way limp. This is a live 1-3 no-limit game, and there's five limpers in front of you, and you have queen-nine offsuit on the button. Someone posted this in the Stack'em forums. So now there's five limpers. You have queen-nine offsuit on the button, and so you limp for $3. Totally okay. Fine, right? Mm-hmm. Now the blinds are in. It's like 7-8-way action, whatever. And the flop's 9-7-5 with 7-5 of spades. And you have the 9 of spades in your hand.
Okay.
And now,
actually, I think that was wrong, Joe, but that's fine. It's queen 9 with the 9 of heart or something. He doesn't have the 9 of spades, but I think it's almost irrelevant. But go ahead.
No, I think that's very relevant.
He doesn't have the 9 of spades. It was 9-7 of spades on the flop. 5 of clubs. So the 9 of spades is on the flop. And so
anyways.
All right. So okay, so
oh, the 9 of spades is on the flop. You have queen 9. But okay. The 9 of spades is on the flop. So anyways, now one of the under the gun guys leads out for or the small blind bets 15, big blind folds, under the gun calls. Middle position, two middle position guys call and the cutoff calls. So there's small blind leads and now three callers for 15, and you're on the button with queen nine, with no spade. And the question's like, what do you do here? It's a limped pot, and everyone's pretty much like over. I think a lot of the guys are like $450 to $500 deep, so like 150 big blinds deep. At least.
That's a tough spot. Like,
so like you have top pair, right? But it is a limped pot. Cool, you don't really want to go broke in a limped pot here, right?
Yeah. I mean, I guess you call, but there's just a lot of turns that you're probably just going to be folding.
Anyways, there were some
7-5, 6-8. Obviously, any like king or ace. I don't know, like you not having any sort of draw in like a huge multi-way pot isn't the greatest. Like, I mean, I guess you can't fold. I guess I just call and I'm not too happy about it. I hope to like bank a queen and make my life easier, but I don't know.
Yeah, that's kind of what I said. Like, our hand's way too good here to fold. Like, we can't fold. Even though it is a limp pot, like, one of the coaches even said, you know, I don't mind folding on this flop. And I just think our hand's way too strong. Like, we have definitely more than enough equity against, like, the field. Like, only one guy can really have us beat there, I would think, in that spot. Maybe,
what,
I mean,
small blind?
Yeah, like, only really the guy who bet can really have us beat.
There's just a lot of bad turns. Like, you're just
Of course there's a lot of bad turns. I mean, there's not too much, you know, I don't think it's going to be easy to get to a showdown or easy to win the pot or anything, but I think we have more than enough equity going forward that we have to at least call there.
So
I don't know, that was kind of the argument that a couple guys, and I said even a hand like Jack 9 or 10-9, you can almost make an argument for folding those hands, but a hand like Queen 9.
I mean, I think if you're calling Queen 9, you have to be calling Jack 9 and 10-9 too. Like, the differences between those aren't that much. I think I'd actually rather have 10-9 than...
No, that's
wrong.
Not right.
Yeah. That's wrong, because people are going to have
you
like...
You want the better kicker. There might be nines out there, 9Xs out there.
You want the better kicker. It's because if you make two pair, you don't want like hands like Jack 8 getting there and double gutters on the flop. And if you have Jack 9, now like 10-8 gets there. And like, the queen's like a clean out. You know what I mean?
I guess.
To make the best hand. Yeah.
Okay,
If you had 10-9, there'd be less gross turns. Like, an 8 would be cool, too.
No, that's not true, because...
No, nothing gives us the nuts. Nothing gives us the nuts. Like, you always want to be drawing to the nuts in, like, a big multi-way pot, and, like, a queen there pretty much, you know, gives us...
Yeah, I guess.
...close to the nuts.
I just think when you get, like, four people in front of you, there's going to be at least one or two more nines out there. So I think the kicker is going to play more often than not here. Yeah, okay. There's a bet in like three callers to you. Are you saying you're the only person with the nine here? That's kind of far-fetched, I would think.
I think the biggest reason is because your outs
your
improve.
I don't know. You're only going to hit your out like less than one out of five, like really rare.
I know, but in a big limp pot like that, you always want to be drawing to the nuts. I mean, I
don't know. I think it's more likely the board's going to roll out like dirty where you have to fold a turn, or the board's going to roll out clean like a deuce three, a pair is the board, a river four, where a kicker is going to matter.
I mean,
let's just say
the board isn't great either, but...
Hold on one second.
My computer's about to die. Hold on.
Yeah.
All right, well, we might just wrap it up without you then, Austin.
Yeah, we got to wrap it up, Austin.
All right, so... Fine. It was great talking to you guys.
This hand, all right, if you cut out... What's your Twitter handle really quick?
@TooCrispy. Yeah.
Where did TooCrispy come from for those people? I'm curious, where did it come from?
Honestly, I'm not sure. I just, like, came up with a name one day randomly, and it just kind of stuck. Like, the first couple people that saw it, they're like, oh, that's a cool name, and so it just... kind of stuck. And
Austin's the man. He can get away with that, dude. I mean,
you were like the Rochambeau champ when you're at the World Series. We forgot to cover that.
Yeah, I was.
His claim to fame.
Yeah, I got
drunk. He won the $500 buy-in World Series event.
I got drunk and won $10,000 playing rock, paper, scissors one night. That was pretty cool.
Who were you up against in the finals? Was it Phil Gordon or...
No, it was...
Well,
there's
first?
A bunch of full tilt
no.
guys.
You... I don't remember.
Okay, well, you won $10,000 in a very skill based game.
Yeah, super skill based. No call and ball whatsoever.
But
it was a lot of fun.
All right. Well, I think that was the last time they had the Rochambeau, right? They didn't have
it.
It
was, so
that.
I'm still the reigning champion.
You're the reigning Rochambeau champ at the World Series. Okay, awesome, Austin. It was good having you on. Just a quick end result on that last hand. Hero raised, got it. Hero raised, and like five people called, and I don't know. I think they end up checking it down, and hero won with queen nine. The turn was a 10, river, a brick, and really? Hero won with nine.
No, yeah, turn other... 10, river, jack.
What?
Yeah, and he won with queen nine. Nine?
Wow.
Did you say he won? No, I don't think he did.
Of course he did. Someone had 9-8, and everybody else had draws. Like that didn't hit a 10 or a jack.
Well, turn 10 over jack, dude. That's what it says on the forums. So 9-8 beats him.
9-8 doesn't beat him, does it?
Yeah. Any 8 beats him.
Oh, maybe 9-8 won.
He lost. He lost the hand, I think.
Okay. But he had the best hand on the flop. So that's what I'm saying. His kicker did play. There was a 9-8 hand. So he had
nothing wrong with raising with the best hand. Nothing wrong at all with that. So if you know everyone else's hand, you got the best hand, go ahead and raise.
Just get it all in there, huh?
I posted, like, this table sounds really juicy. Lock the doors, throw away the keys, you know, whenever you're in a game like that. So, but all right, it was good having you on today, Austin.
Thanks for having me, guys. I appreciate it.
Input, appreciate it. So this is Cash Plays for Quadjax at quadjax.com, brought to you by Stack and Coaching. Use promo code quadjax82 for a free day trial at our site, Stack and Coaching. You can see the banner at quadjax.com. You can follow us on Twitter at Nicolac Poker. Joe's at Joe Tehan. And Austin, again, is at 2Crispy. So thanks for listening, guys, and we'll see you guys next time.
Thanks. All right.
See you guys later.